Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, for game number two, Texas San Antonio versus Texas Christian University.
Pretty much
exact same bands that we saw in game one. Where's the Varus band? Hello? What's going on?
No adaptive strategies yet so far from either of these teams. Where do you ban lag? I think that would be a good ban for TCU to consider.
There's a Galio ban.
Uh-oh.
But not a Varus ban. What's going on? What the heck? Did they need a reminder what happened game one?
I think maybe they're a little bit more confident in the abilities of their Kog'Maw rather than the threat of a Varus popping off once again. Maybe just getting... They're just thinking, they're going to prioritize the Varus.
First pick Varus. Okay, so that's their plan.
Well played. Does it matter?
Does Hank pick Kog'Maw now instead and just does the same thing but in reverse? Is this Christian University how to play Kog'Maw? Is that what we're going to see here?
Ouch, yeah, the BM show you how it's done kind of thing. This Varus has got to go 20-0, otherwise it's just going to be a disgrace.
Orn pick by Want A Asian. So it's, are we just going to have the same team comp on both sides, just flip-flopped? The BM? I want to see it.
I mean, I definitely like the Orn pick, but the... Well, let's see. Well, Orn was also on...
Oh, man.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Okay, Kha'Zix. Kha'Zix did not get banned this time around. It's looking like we're not going to see the same team comps flip-flopped on both sides this time around.
Yeah, it was banned, the last ban from Red Side last game, I believe. But if Kha'Zix is very strong right now, a little bit of a hidden OP, at least in solo queue, tends to one-shot people if you glance at him in the wrong way. But if anybody on TCU is going to be able to handle it, might be Nick5131. He's a very high-ranked jungler. Alistair's going to be the priority here, though. There's that cheeky Fiddlesticks hover.
The Fiddlesticks. The middle sticks. These guys are a bunch of memers, man. I love it.
Speaking of memers, is this going to be the Ivern? I haven't seen him in a while.
Locked in? Locked in. Come on, 3 seconds. No! No, what do you mean, Kane?
Going to be the Kane instead. Not really sure about that matchup, and I'm not very well-versed in jungle. But I think Kane definitely has a bit of a mobility, able to escape from the Kha'Zix if Kha'Zix decides to invade or go for some fancy 1v1s. Also a very good ganker early on. And look, maybe might be going for two assassins. A versatile pick, of course, with the ability to choose one path or the other. Back into the banned stage. Now the Xerath that was banned last game comes through for Infernal Susan.
Oh, and now this time we're going to see the Orianna get banned again. How do you feel about the team comp for Texas Christian University here? Kha'Zix definitely beats Kane early on in the game. Kane literally has no passive.
Right,
Random Tom catch ban.
Kane is a glorified melee minion that can travel through walls in the very first 20 minutes in the game if he's having a bad one. Tom Kench is going to be taken away, if they decide to go for that Kog'Maw later on, he's not going to have that safety.
The way that it did game one, San Antonio with that Kha'Zix is just going to stomp on Texas Christian University. The Anivia ban probably coming against Lemur here. Another target ban is what we're going to see there. Final bans getting rounded out here. But Texas Christian University decides to ban. They still haven't picked an AD carry, so I'd like to see maybe like an AD carry ban here. Maybe a Kog'Maw. Test Varus.
Clock's ticking. Better ban something.
Eric instead deciding that defensive ultimate was a little bit too much in turning team fights around in their favor. Something that I agree with. Hopefully an 80 carry pick and not Garen. I was hearing people in the chat saying how Hank wanted to play Ashe, and I think that's what's going to get locked in here. Hovering over that Caitlyn. Oh, but instead it's going to be the Xayah pick. And they didn't ban Rakan.
Yeah, that's probably going to be the duo picked up here. Alistair is already taken down by TCU on that side, so no doubt that's going to be the final one
right
for the side of San Antonio. I think with that knowledge. Bot lane.
Another oppressive bot lane going to be towards the San Antonio side. They might be able to take over like they did first game. Jarvan the Fourth going to be locked in here, trying to mimic what San Antonio did to them first game. The LeBlanc, however, going to be locked in versus that Xerath, and that can be a matchup that can go either way. Either Xerath pokes out LeBlanc early on, or LeBlanc just gets the assassination, and that's what we're seeing earlier. That Rakan pick is going to be locked in. It's looking like he's opting to take Ignite this time around. The exhaust onto Southwind here. We saw in game number one, San Antonio with that Ignite actually did a lot of very aggressive plays in the bot lane, particularly, that allowed them to take over the game later on. Another repeat of that here. Hello, I'm Hank. Definitely strutted his stuff on Varus last game, going 16-1-8. And I think that's going to be a very similar scoreline this time around.
Yeah, wow. Xayah, Rakan.
It's a tough matchup. No matter what you pick against that, like Xayah, Rakan, they synergize so well, purposely, of course. It's almost an unbeatable bot lane. Or Arbitrary? I'm not even sure how you pronounce that. He's trying to replicate the success that San Antonio had by picking that Varus. But I'm not convinced that it's going to be enough. What do you think of the other matchups here?
I think LeBlanc versus Xerath, the onus is definitely on Lemur to play his heart out during the first couple minutes just because of how hard LeBlanc falls off in this current meta. I think she becomes a glorified siege minion after like 30 minutes or so, just because it's so hard for her to get in and deal damage. But in the very beginning of the game, you know, especially when Xerath is still trying to get his mana cost under control and like his abilities don't deal that much damage, it's going to be your time to shine. Looking at Kayn versus Kha'Zix, I think you mentioned before, Kha'Zix is definitely a stronger independent jungler who don't need no team early on. So I think it's going to be up to Nick to have to play defensive to try to keep his own jungle under control in case Kha'Zix decides to go for any invades. But Nick and Lemur are both very high-ranked players. I think if Tarsier decides to get too cheeky around the mid lane area, then he might find himself in trouble. But up in the top lane, J4, I haven't seen J4 top in a long time. I think picked more so for his teamfight potential and maybe also as a slate flex. Actually, was the Jarvan picked? Jarvan was picked at what stage? Do you remember?
The jungler for San Antonio.
Yeah, so I think maybe more of just like a little bit of a flex until they decided to lock in the Kayn instead.
For sure, trying to throw them off in the pick and ban phase. And I think you hinted at something a little bit earlier here. Look at the summoner spell difference between Lemur and Infernal Susan here. Xerath opting to take the barrier for LeBlanc's burst damage. However, LeBlanc here, or Lemur, teleport. You saw Lemur try and get his team to rally behind him in game one with his Talia pickoffs. He was able to do a lot of work on his own, but ultimately didn't have that impact in game one in order to carry his team. This time he's taking a very different approach, opting to take that teleport instead. So now it's looking like his plan is just to crap on Infernal Susan and use that teleport to gank bot lane along with Jarvan. That could be an easy 4-5 man gank. Something that can go in favor of Texas Christian University here.
Yeah, you definitely don't want to leave your bot lane to fight Xayah, Rakan by themselves. I think anytime you see a fight go down there, and we didn't notice last game, tons of map plays all around. I think there was a 5v5 in the mid lane, like very early on in the game. Both of these teams are pretty on point with their teleport timings, at least trying to match each other and to help each other out when fights break out. So, if anything, like this won't be a boring one. It's gonna be Lemur trying to make early plays. If not against his lane opponent, definitely going to try to look for blood in other lanes, get himself fed. And I guess that opposes a little bit with the Kayn pick, just because of how long it takes for Kayn to come online.
Right.
Yeah.
I think that's going to be a huge issue, actually. Kha'Zix being that dominant early game pressure against Kayn does mean that he gets priority onto Lemur in terms of getting kills. And if Lemur falls behind, so too will the rest of his team, because it looks like they're going for that mid-centric kind of team comp here with that LeBlanc and the teleport. Is able to just poop on them all in the mid lane. That's not going to be anything going down bot side. And if that happens, then hello, I'm Hank. He's going to end up popping off just as he did game one. So it could go either way once again. This time we're seeing Jarvan the Fourth opting to take Electrocute once again. Is that actually standard on Jarvan the Fourth?
Jarvan the Fourth, I actually don't know. I've just seen so much unsealed spellbook in the plays that I've been seeing recently. It's hard for me to tell anymore.
Oh, a very quick loading screen, looking like Texas Christian University definitely fixed their internet issues, as we're already going to start off the game here. Texas San Antonio versus Texas Christian University. San Antonio is on the red side, with Christian University being on blue side. We saw game one. It looks like they might try and get an early invade off, as San Antonio is grouping towards the mid river.
Yeah, this is definitely more of a spearhead formation from the side of San Antonio compared to last game. We see TCU's fanned out quite far. The red ping goes under the bush, where Alistair, unbeknownst, does feel a little bit scared, has to walk away from Tarsier, despite that being the only person he's seen so far.
It's looking like Tarsier's going to get that early ward on. Dust it off. He gets that early jungle presence and knows exactly where Nick starts off. Minions have spawned. Start red side. That's going to give Tarsier on Kha'Zix here a lot of early game information. And early game information on Kha'Zix is pretty huge, because it means that he gets a lot more options than Nick does in terms of whether he decides to invade or get an early gank off.
Yeah, the last thing you want to do as a weak early game Kayn is to run into a giant bug hiding in your brush when you're trying to take down your second buff.
Once again, we're seeing standard starts for both junglers here. Only difference is that Nick is going to be spotted in his jungle, while Tarsier is not. It tends to be the same kind of setup. Both junglers go buff to wolves to other buff. However, opting to go towards the wraiths instead, knowing that Kayn has that nice, like, wave clear in terms of that, might be able to get a quicker full clear off. Well,
some
the bot lane,
coming
a
down.
Little bit of a scuffle.
Yep, Grand Engine's going to just barely miss an Arbery. Good step backwards, and that's CC for both supports burned already. Lightning Orb going to miss just barely from Xerath as well. Transmuted Golem, Wanted Agent, just playing the farm game up until now. There's some couple cooldowns coming out from Wanted Agent right now, but another engage on the South Wind. The Hail of Arrows comes out to slow them just enough. The root is not going to land from Xayah. It means that's the end of that fight. Ooh, Lemur walks right into that Arcano Pulse.
You're seeing Shadowy Figure here with that Ignite, just as he did game one, go very aggressive. You've seen him engage not once, but twice so early on in the bot lane. And that might allow them to push in Arbery and South Wind here.
Lemur distorts in. That cooldown's now down. Tarsier is coming around to cut off the backside. Means Lemur has to escape to the right. Fails the leap over the wall. Tarsier's feeling a little bit embarrassed about that one.
The Mastery 7B makes sure that LeBlanc is just able in a way.
Yeah, she's going to have to burn a little bit more mana to escape that one, but not the worst. Wanted Asian landing the good knockup on a Transmuted Gold. That orange trades so hard. And barely uses any mana across his entire combo.
Coming in from that combo as well. Normally you'd expect Jarvan to be doing the majority of the damage in the top lane, but that's not the case, as we saw in that trade there.
Yeah, Warren's got some really nasty base damages. Jarvan definitely needs a few items before he starts to hurt.
A lot of pressure going on into bot side, and even a little bit mid here, an early gank off coming in from Kha'Zix. Kayn, however, nowhere to be seen yet. He is looking bot, however. Kaipin there.
Southwind walks forward a little bit early. There is a ward in the Tribush as well. That was definitely what spotted it out.
Behavior in the lane just made it so obvious that Kayn was there. But at least they get to use this to their advantage if they pretend to walk up as if Kayn was there. Oh, wait a minute.
Oh yeah, Kayn's still here. It did try to ward off Southwind before he was able to get that in arch, but the blade's reach just doing a little bit of tickle to Hello I'm Hank as he just walks out of there.
Could have been first blood there. Kayn, however, was not able to respond in time to make anything out of it. Not even any summoner spells used in that little trade there.
Yeah, Southwind
is keeping their composure.
Southwind definitely took the brunt of that engagement, despite being the ones that were outnumbering them. He's gonna have a little bit harder time to heal up, and he's gonna have to rely on his passive. Both mid laners very low on mana so far. Here comes Nick, 5131, Infernal Susan. Does have to flash out. First blood goes to LeBlanc. Wonderful amount of burst damage coming out from her combo.
Remember when I said that Tarsier was going to be on Kha'Zix getting the majority of the early game ganks off? Yeah, about that. Looks like I'm wrong.
Power farming the jungle, went back for those two really long swords. Meanwhile, Kane has yet to pick up an offensive item. Just got his two jungle items so far, but he's definitely going to be feeling pretty good about that first blood assist.
And for Kane, getting first blood assists like that so early on into the game is actually pretty nice, because it means that you get access to your actual passive a little bit sooner. You're seeing he's already level 5, so he almost has his ultimate up. And that means he's getting another gank off and his transformation as well.
So we've still yet to see Shadowy Figure use this Ignite much effect. Every time I see Arborary and Southwind walk next to each other like that, I'm just thinking, oh, Shadowy Figure is going to go in for that engage.
A little bit low on mana here, so I actually play a lot of Okan myself. He doesn't have enough mana to do the full combo and live that, actually. So it's looking like he's letting that mana regen do its thing, zoning Arborary on Varus from getting as much CS as he can deny.
Oh,
CS
wow.
Difference here. 47 to 38 CS down in the bot lane.
A little bit of an Easter egg there. When all of those stopwatches activated, the chat immediately popped up with everybody on both teams just bought a stopwatch, so that was interesting.
League of Stopwatches still going taken into full effect here, but you know what I'm not seeing that I saw in game one from both teams? The disconnect.
Frozen Smite goes down on Infernal Susan, but Tarsier is here to back him up. Flash already forced out of Nick, but another flash on Kha'Zix to get away from Lemur. The Ethereal Chains lands across the wall. The stopwatch might seal his fate here. Did put himself in range of Lemur just a little bit longer, but now Azeroth is a little bit safe. Has the ability to pop the ultimate. Isn't able to land it on Nick, though. Might have to work on his...
The support roam from bot lane already making his way
in. Yeah,
mid.
Wow. Ooh, long range engage from Akan. Is there damage to follow up, though? It's just a 3v2, despite them being a little bit low. Both supports are up on the map. This is another 5v5 brawl around the middle area of the map, so for both of these teams. Lemur's still on the run here. Shadowy Figure pops his Zhonya to try to dodge that Jarvan damage, I think. But Lemur did go down. But Southwind's gonna pop the Rakan to safety, unfortunately. Hello, I'm Hank is now here. This could be Hello, I'm Hank's first couple kills of the game. We saw him pop off last time. Wan and Asians. In a little bit of a messy spot right now, but does stopwatch himself to safety. Isn't able to land the knock-up over the wall. Infernal Susan field goals the Arcano Pulse, means that that is the end of that engage.
Really wanted all of that. He used both his summoner spells just trying to secure a kill there. A little bit too cheeky, if you ask me. Flashes the mastery to make sure that everything's okay. But I don't know. I think that was a little bit too many resources coming out of Zaya. And nothing came out of it, aside from the kill onto Lemur.
That was just a lot of resources from both teams, period. I think a 5v5 at 7 minutes into the game in the middle river, that's kind of... I don't see that very often.
Been in game 1 where we saw that 5v5 down by bot side. This time we're taking it up top, however, that 5v5. Unlike the first game, though, we don't have a damn near ace 10 minutes into the game.
And we see Tarsier going for that farm-heavy strategy this game. It's starting to pay dividends now. He's matching CS with the mid laners, actually. Only Zaya has a higher farm number. Well, actually, no. He's pretty close to Ornn, but doing impressively well despite that one death. And Nick does have that one assist. Wasn't able to pick up anything extra despite getting the jump on the Xerath at the very beginning of that last fight. Arce is going to take away his blue buff, so two more buffs picked up for the jungle. Look at these guys, they're like almost on top of each other. I think Nick just finished up his blue buff as well.
I'm actually rather surprised there. I was pretty sure that Tarsier was going to have a lot more impact in the early game, but it's looking like he's opting for a more farm-heavy strategy, kind of similar to what like you'd see from like a Shyvana or something like that, where you farm a lot in the early game, get a couple levels ahead of the enemy jungler, and then you just take over the game from there.
Yeah, I think that earlier attempt that caused his death actually was supposed to be his debut into the game instead. Found himself at the receiving end of LeBlanc's combo, unfortunately, but he is about 200 gold ahead of his opponent right now, so at least the farm is doing something for him.
Meanwhile, in the bot lane, you saw Shadowy Figure there, he... Oh, wait a minute.
Can't go through walls with that, it wants the Asian.
LeBlanc Distortion not going to full hello, I'm Hank. He's just going to dodge what doesn't need to be dodged. Shadowy Figure, however, as I was trying to say earlier, the zombie ward there. And you're seeing because of that, he has a lot of vision for his team. The entire bot side of the river, the dragon as well. Defensive ward setup. So in terms of bot lane, they're looking very safe and they have a lot of control down bot side to play around with. Whether it's to secure that early Ocean Drake or to get a gank off mid or bottom. Clear out a couple wards of his own. Let me see what they can go with here.
I'm looking at this mid lane matchup, and this time Lemur's prowess over his opponent's definitely showing earlier. No more botched 2v1 early on to put himself behind. He's got a solid farm lead and 2 kills. Putting Xerath on the back foot, Nick's still focusing this bot lane. I think this is a smart strategy considering Xayah and Rakan's potential. But unfortunately, we haven't really seen it yet. Lemur's gonna have to distort into the path, went to the Prometheus school of running away from things, unfortunately. But it's good enough to get him away. He was able to get enough distance. Ethereal Chains is going to pop the critical damage on Infernal Susan, who's very low on mana. But Wanted Asian still here. Blade's Reach is going to just barely snow Wanted Asian, keep him from pursuing Lemur any further.
Arceus was not even in a position to contest that in the slightest. He was walking back from his base. That could have turned ugly had either one of those guys stood there a little bit too long.
Yeah, he just finished his warrior enchantment. He's itching to put that to some use. But trying to clear out a ward, went for the Grand Entrance. Means he isn't able to escape until Xayah walks back for the W away.
Surprised I didn't see a Chain of Corruption coming out from Arborary there. That could have been a very easy kill from a greedy Shadowy Figure. A little bit cheeky in their playstyle here. Oh, wait a minute. The face check into the bush.
Oh my god, Lemur is online, but Tarsier does quite a bit himself, right of the arcane. The pop back right into the claws of Kha'Zix.
This happened, but it just wasn't enough. Meanwhile, on the bot lane, that's going to be the engage from Rakan.
Yeah, good knockup back in Arborary, but did miss Southwind. Southwind did already pop the Unstoppable, or the Unbreakable Will. Means that's one solid cooldown burned away by Shadowy Figure. And hello, I'm Hank. The Ignite, again, unused.
Oh yeah, but can we just talk about what Lemur did?
Oh, the flash engaged. There is the because Tarsier is here to back him up. A good route onto both Hello, I'm Hank and Arborary, who actually stopwatched the Xayah damage. There's the first teleport coming in from top lane, cancelled by Transmuted Gold as soon as Shadowy Figure and his company back off.
Example showcasing the power of stopwatch. Had Arborary not had stopwatch in that situation, he would have definitely died. But because he did, he was able to Zonius himself to safety. Transmuted Gold, trying to threaten with that teleport. Forces a gank that could have been an easy 2 kills. Ends up being nothing for nothing except a couple of cooldowns down.
Yeah, Tarsier blue balled in his gank attempt once again. 90 CS to 55, though. He's not making light of his time away from the lanes, at the very least. And I think that's still going to be one scary Kha'Zix. We saw what he was able to do to a 2-kill LeBlanc just earlier. Although, no doubt, if not the distraction from Infernal Susan, Lemur could have picked that up, half-healthing Infernal Susan with almost no effort at all.
Talk about what Lemur's doing these past couple of games. Despite him getting killed off in that last exchange there, that was amazing. The amount of juice from that distortion almost caught him away to safety. I think we're going to see some really hype plays come out of Lemur in this game here.
Mm-hmm. It's again, that timer ticking away for LeBlanc before she dies of old age. Want to see more plays come out of him. It's 13 minutes into the game so far. The Searing Charge from Wanted Asian is going to miss. Mitch prompts Transmuted Gold to go in. It's winning the trade so far. The emo comes out as he knows that Transmuted Gold doesn't have enough to finish him off. But there's the knockup on a Hello, I'm Hank. Both supports have engaged on the AD carries, but Nick is here. Kha'Zix is way on the other side of the map. Keep that in mind. A good route from Xayah onto the bot lane, but Nick is now in the front. He's going to slice into Shadowy Figure, but now forced to run away. Still a very squishy person. Gets the heal from walking through the wall, and there's the ultimate from Shadowy Figure. Allows Hello, I'm Hank to pick up the kill. Transmuted Gold's a little bit low on the top lane, but the flash forward prompts the Featherstorm from Hello, I'm Hank. Means he's able to escape that one. Lemur's going to miss the chains. Pops backwards. Did have to roam down all the way from mid. Thankfully for him, his opponent had to follow suit.
Little bit of miscommunication on Texas Christian University's part there. You saw their bot lane had the perfect opportunity to go in. Arborary missed the Chain of Corruption, however, and that forced them both to back.
Oh, it's Nick's turn to try the 2v1. Or not.
Nick, however, didn't get the memo. He engaged anyways and almost paid with his life.
Yeah, just thankfully, a quick note
Beamer on the block was able to roam down bot side and turn things around before things got messy.
Mm-hmm. Just a quick note about what just happened top lane. So Transmuted Gold didn't die in that exchange, but he was forced out of lane. And since Tarsier was already up there, he saw what was happening in bot lane, knew that he couldn't make it down there in time to make a difference. Instead, Focus the top lane was able to secure top turret, or first turret for his team. And the blue buff as well.
That's actually a 3k gold difference between both teams now. Not a lot of kills going on. We're seeing a little bit of a slower start. In game number one, it was already 6-8 at this point. Bit of a slow start. That's not going to stop San Antonio from securing a lead through CS and objectives kills so far.
Yeah, I'm just looking at huge farm lanes in top jungle and bottom lane for San Antonio already. And I think that the Ornn just, the Jarvan was never able to pick up a lead where he's able to win trades very heavily against Ornn. Leaves Ornn to be able to free farm. And with his 3 wave clear ability, certainly not a problem for him. Meanwhile, in the bottom lane, I think it's just Hello, I'm Hank. Maybe being the stronger player in this case, I was noticing a lot earlier when they were going for those trades, even though Arbitrary and Southwind weren't dying, Arbitrary was electing to go for damage rather than farming properly, and then it wasn't able to. Wanda Asian sets up the trap, and the quickness is coming out to stun Southwind, but Arbitrary is well safe. He's gonna get knocked up by Wanda Asian, who's now stunned out of turret, though. This could be trouble for him. There is no Chain of Corruptions. This has already been used. I'm not even sure what it's seen right there, but meanwhile, Rift Hill's gonna get someone, but the teleport from Transmuted Gold is gonna force the Hourglass out from Hello, I'm Hank. That ultimate from Ornn's gonna catch Arbitrary. Means it's gonna be a little bit slower to catch up, but Wanda Asian has to charge out. No kills picked up by either side so there, but that was looking really dangerous from the re-engage from Transmuted Gold.
Seeing that stopwatch once again come in clutch as Hello, I'm Hank is safe in that exchange. However, that allows Texas Christian University to combat using the Rift Herald and getting that mid-tier turret. And that opens up a lot of options for them in San Antonio's jungle here.
Yeah, they're going to narrow the gold deficit to 2,500. They're going to push into middle turret. Might give them a little bit of a position on Dragon as well. Ping's going down, they're just trying, they're trying to go for the invade right now. It's a little risky as Tarsier finds Nick, but Lemur's just around the wall, pops the gunblade for the slow as well, isn't able to finish the combo, but the heal from Rakan's just barely enough to keep Tarsier alive. What a save by the support from the side of TCU.
Can I get some Manka S in the chat? That was almost another kill. But that is going to give Texas University, or Texas Christian University, however, priority to take this dragon uncontested.
And
several members of San Antonio are forced to back here.
And I misspoke, that was actually the support from San Antonio. But again, yeah, Texas Christian University going to make good use of forcing the jungler to back, picks up the first dragon in the game, like they did last game. We'll see if they're able to maintain control of that objective as the game goes on.
You're seeing here, unlike game one, there's not a lot of kills going on both sides. However, both Texas Christian University, more so, are playing that objective game really strong. That's allowed them to come back into this game and close in that gold deficit. And look at this, you're seeing Zareth really Banshee's Veil against LeBlanc, and that means that he's going to have some mana troubles in the mid game, and maybe not enough damage to carry in the late.
Yeah, Banshee's not a terrible item to build first, perhaps, but you do really want to go for that Murloc Nomicon. Prevents you from running out of mana in the team fights, especially when someone like Zareth does have to rely on his passive, but you have to get an auto attack range to pop that off. Meanwhile, top laners have transported themselves down to the bottom.
An exchange of swapping lanes here.
Yeah, I think a little bit. I think perhaps Hello, I'm Hank and Shadowy Figure knew that Arbitrary and Southwind were going to go top lane to try to take down that turret instead, because usually the onus would have been. Meanwhile, as the team fight breaking down, the Chain of Corruptions goes down, but Arbitrary is losing this fight. There's the Featherstorm to try to win this 2v4 so far. Lemur's here as well. There's the right of a cane for a little bit of support from Long from downtown, but Southwind takes the first kill onto Hello, I'm Hank.
However,
that's Zaya's first
kill we've
death.
Seen in a while.
Yeah. Also,
and you see it here that Christian University was able to, unlike in the early game, they had a lot of really good coordination, able to rotate topside and make that 4v2 happen. They lose tier 1 mid for it, and that opens up again options in the jungle, but here comes the team fight.
Oh, Nick is transformed, does have the knockup now on the stretching, or on the reaching strike, on the reach, Blade's reach. Meanwhile, Wanted Asia takes down Lemur in response for his support, dying. Zaya is still dead, keep that in mind, but Tarsier picks up Varus on the backside to even that up. Tarsier's inside the base now, he's trying to look for more kills here, but he's a little trapped as Nick is gonna follow him across the wall and picks up that kill.
Brings me to Gold, however, just barely walking him from bot lane without that teleport that was used in the earlier team fights. He's actually not able to contest any of this at all, showing up just a little too late to the party.
And so, wow, I even lost track of how many kills I was trying to count the number of kills going across to both teams. Zai was already dead at the beginning of that. Shadowy figure did go down. Kha'Zix was the last dead. I believe a 2-for-3 if you wanted to count that Zai earlier.
It's going to be the Baron spawning in. Unlike the Drake, which hasn't seen a lot of priority in these games lately, I think Baron is definitely an objective that you're going to be looking for if you're on either side of the team. Texas Christian University has been able to play the objective game really well here, despite San Antonio getting a lot of early game kills. Other 3v2 in the bot lane. Going to back off, chill a little bit, make sure that they farm up to get the gold. Once again, there's a 4k gold difference between both teams, but I don't think that's going to stop Texas Christian University from trying to play the objective game a little bit better and get themselves back in that gold lead. Yeah. Meanwhile, you're seeing some deficits here. Difference between Hello, I'm Hank and Arborary. Gensu's Rageblade finally being completed by Arborary on the other hand.
Good knockup from Blade's Reach. Yeah, going to prevent any sort of engage from Shadowy Figure. Infernal Susan was standing by just enough range for him to contribute to that if something had happened. But fortunately for Nick, no cheeky plays coming out from Shadow Figure that time. Lemur's going to be the one to mash the split push of Modern Aging. He's taking quite a bit of damage. The shield's not going to block much. Meanwhile, Infernal Susan loses his Banshee's Veil to Smite. Means he has to flash across the wall before Alistair can lay his hands on him.
Oof. Oh, man. Those a lot of cooldowns being used in those couple exchanges there that are going to come in clutch later on in the game. You're seeing Lemur trying to have a lot of...
3v3 engaged. The Rakan has the opponent. He gets the Chimes onto the backline as well. Southland's already very low. Going to go down to Infernal Susan. Meanwhile, Transmuted Gold picks it back up onto Tarsier, who's one of the stronger members on the enemy team right now. Lemur is already forced to back off as he's not able to make things happen when three people are focusing him like that. The knockup's just barely going to miss as Lemur reacts in time with the distortion.
Reaction time, though. Lemur has been a star player for Texas Christian University, and you saw him use that teleport for the first time this game. Oh, wait a minute. The
Ooh, Shadowy Figure's still playing so aggressively, does have Battle Dance to get back out. Lemur's trying to clear this wave, takes a root to the face in response.
Pretty ugly for either team. Xerath finally making his way towards bot lane, seeing if he can poke them out, allowing San Antonio to get this siege. But instead, it's looking like both teams are going to back up here a little bit, maybe trying to get a little bit of plays going around the Baron.
Oh, Lemur's a little low. Could die to Wands of Asian. Of course, it's really hard to catch a LeBlanc. But you never know. The misplays are always... There's always a potential for misplay. Accidentally distorting back too early, for example, or something like that. The clone's not going to... Well, what an Asian, at least because Lemur did go to mid lane to try to clear that wave, but again, wow, what was that heal from Gunblade? That was incredible. It was a couple hundred health. Nick is here, the entire team is here for the side of TCU, but meanwhile, Infernal Susan and the rest of them aren't far behind. Tarsio's got his eyes on Lemur, but meanwhile, Nick is wreaking havoc on the Xerath, does have to back up, doesn't have the cooldowns left to finish him off. Or to finish off Wanted Asian, rather.
The amount of damage that Inferno Susan was able to pop out there against Nick there. In any other situation, he shouldn't have been able to drop Nick to that low HP.
Yeah, Kane's squishy. He's gone the Scythe path, but he doesn't have any items. Did elect for the Warrior enchant, means he doesn't have anything other than that cloth armor and the health from Age to help him out right now. Can't really
forcing the both of them to back out, and that means that this Ocean Drake goes uncontested.
Yeah, also means a 5,000 gold lead now for the side of San Antonio, and this is similar to what happened last game. They have the better control over the outer turrets, means that they get that gold lead first, and then with that gold lead, they're able to keep TCU from ever reestablishing control of the map and able to pick up some of those outer turrets for themselves. At least very hard fought. Lemur's going to prompt the Feather Dance, or the Feather Storm out from Shadowy Figure. Or Shadowy Figure is going to come back in with the quickness to try to turn that one around, but Arborary and Nick are here. Shadowy Figure gets snared in place for what seems like years, and he goes down.
Oh, I'm Hank forced to flash out in order to keep himself safe. Texas Christian University, hasn't been able to get as many kills and close off as many deals. And aside from that, they're also losing the objective game at this point. However, they have improved their communication a lot. You're seeing that this team here has been able to group as five and get a lot of collapses on this game so far. Hasn't proven to pay off because they haven't gotten any kills to match with that. However, it's still a very good sign that they'll be able to come back in this game. San Antonio, however, from sieging mid-turret, teleport coming down from Rakan, surprisingly enough.
Yeah, they still want to defend this, though, but they aren't able to really get across. You saw Nick there was kind of leaning around the edge there, didn't decide to go in, means they're going to lose the turret. But yeah, what I'm seeing right now is just San Antonio, it's very similar to last game where San Antonio is the one usually going for the engages, and then if TCU finds an opening, they're able to turn around, but on the map, on the objective control side and on the tower killing side, there's just no response so far. Meanwhile, Hello, I'm Hank has already tripled his death count tonight, just in this last couple minutes. Arbor is going to be on the receiving end of Tarsier's pincers, though. But meanwhile, Southwind's trying to pull out the engaged. Tarsier, still not dead, is able to crawl out of that one. Shocking Orb's going to find Kane, but Transmuted Gold is not stunned, picks up Tarsier with the Flash Ultimate. The good knockup and the Shadowy Figure means he has to Battle Dance out of there, but there's Transmuted Gold again. The EQ is off cooldown, is a little bit of trouble right now, as Infernal Susan so far is untouched. That changes right now as the chain lands. He could go down. There's the ultimate from Kane to finish him off. Nick is on a killing spree now, and Jarvan's still alive, still contributing CC to this team fight. That was a huge team fight, a 4-for-none clean fight by TCU.
That's amazing. You're seeing, just as it happened in the first game, Texas Christian University opting to take those really extended fights. You saw LeBlanc was able to get a lot of damage at the Hello, I'm Hank. Knowing that he didn't have the flash earlier in the game means that he gets caught out. Rakan tries to make things go in their favor, but it's just not enough, as Texas Christian University, again, with that five-man collapse, able to get the kills off when they needed it most, and now that allows them to reestablish their objective control that they needed early on in the game as they try and threaten this Baron.
Yeah, Redemption's going to do a little bit of damage.
Not enough.
No smite available means Zaya could have gotten lucky right there, but instead Arbore was able to finish off a good clean Baron take after that clean team fight as well, and that was the first big advantage that I've seen TCU takes so far. They aren't up in gold just yet, but I think once they start taking into those turrets, that'll very quickly change.
Listen, back into the game here. Look at this. Kane is 3-0 right now. Lemur on LeBlanc is 4-3 on the other hand. Not a single member on San Antonio's side has as many kills as those two have, at least not in a 1v1 situation. So you're definitely seeing that a lot of the kills are coming on to Texas Christian University. And I think that's actually going to come in clutch in the late game. Unfortunately, you do have to keep in mind that they do have a LeBlanc who does fall off later into the game. Jarvan just tends to fall off just a tiny bit because he opted to take damage. On the other hand, Kha'Zix will end up becoming unkillable in the late game, and then Hello, I'm Hank and Infernal Susan are going to be dishing out tons of damage in the late game. So I think TCU needs to close out this game with that Baron, or at least get a major advantage off of it. Right about now, you're seeing they're going to threaten mid, and through it's going to miss.
Yeah, I think they're going to elect to have Lemur split pushing as the game gets later in years. Lemur's going to dodge away those. A little bit of frontline play right there from the LeBlanc, but instead a stun and a snare going back onto Wanted Asian. Siri charged right into the wall to try to get a knockup onto Nick, who's just a little bit too far away for that to land. Baroned up minions, giving Hello, I'm Hank quite a little bit of trouble as he's not quite able to clear these out just yet. But despite that, you know, San Antonio pushing quite aggressively here.
Yeah, I mean, I'm rather surprised that they're able to do this so well, but hold on, maybe I'm speaking a little bit too soon.
Yeah, here's a little bit of an attempt at a pincer. Rakan did go straight for Arbory, but it wasn't enough to keep his Eric 80 carry alive. Tarsier is trying to go for that backline flank, but he's very quickly warded up by the rest of the team. Meanwhile, the shutdown on to the Kane from Rakan, but Lemur is now in a killing spree as Orin was trying to 1v3 that fight. Infernal Susan's now in range of Arbore, means he's going to be in a little bit of trouble. He's also out of mana. There's no way he survives that one.
Oh man, and now you're looking how this is starting to look a little bit how game one was. However, it's looking like Arbore is going to be the AD carry in charge. You're seeing as Varus, he was able to get three kills in that last team fight rather easily. Zaya used her ultimate, as we saw in that last team fight, a little too early. Rakan tried to save her once again, but it was a little bit too late. That Featherstorm is just such a pivotal cooldown, and as soon as that went down, you're seeing Arbory on the Varus popping with that Ginsu's Rageblade, coming in clutch, got an easy three kills out of that last exchange, and that's gonna be the mid inhibitor going down real soon, and top turret being pressured as well.
huge props.
They were looking for. They're actually making something out of that Baron after all. You saw they were getting sieged in the mid lane, but they were able to turn things around. And now it's looking like TCU's in command of this game.
Yeah, huge props to them for making perfect use of their Baron buff. I wanted to see, my mental note to myself was, what if they don't have a gold lead by the time that Baron buff wears off with the rate that LeBlanc falls off? It was going to be really hard for them to win that game. If that had been the case, instead they're able to get the good teamfight. That wasn't even a full-on teamfight, as Transmuted Gold was just split-pushing the entire time up in top lane, picked up the top inner turret as well, while his team picked up the mid lane inhibitor.
You even saw that come in clutch, because he was able to pressure top turret so well that allowed TCU to pick up this free Infernal Drake. And that's going to be really nice, keeping LeBlanc just relevant for a little while longer, and Arbery gets a little bit closer to that late-game extreme power spike, hyper carry kind of thing.
Right, yeah, this match is the tale of Varus on both sides. Two different AD carries across two different teams right now, popping off on the Varus pick. Almost
100% we're seeing a Varus ban in Game 3, 100%.
Yeah, either that or they just decide to go for the first pick again. Maybe they just it's gonna be up to San Antonio to make that decision, right? I mean, they know that they're good with the Varus, so yeah. No, I actually totally agree with you. I don't think that TCU is gonna be leaving that Varus up if they don't have the option to first pick it anymore.
It's just a little too strong, but that's Game 3. We're looking a little ahead. TCU still needs to win this game first, and they're finally going to get that bot tier 1 turret down. Looking for a little bit more towards the bot side, but you're seeing San Antonio has a lot of vision control. That's not going to allow them to siege that much, especially now since TCU's Baron buff is now gone. It's going to be very tough. Meanwhile, towards the top lane, Want the Nation and Tarsier looking to get a kill or pick off onto Transmuted Gold to get them back into the game.
Yeah, I'm not really sure if I like this decision much. Even if they get the kill, which they might not. Just barely not able to escape that one. They're going to lose this one underneath their own turret. Arbery with another pickup. Southwind taking up that turret so easily with the Unbreakable Will. I'm thinking that they're also going to lose this turret, but without the minion wave, it might be a little bit harder to call.
Nick going a little bit too deep here, trying to get that kill. But now with Khan goes down.
Yeah, they just abandoned this
gold
one.
Goes down. Transmuted Gold still had teleport, even if they tried to contest that. It wouldn't take much for a team fight to not go in their favor. They're forced to give that up. Buff not being there, they're allowed to siege on that fairly easily. San Antonio in a position to contest. Infernal Susan just having to go back, finding himself out of mana. And with two members of San Antonio topside, that means that bottom turret just goes down for free, honestly.
Yeah. Just think that's the wrong time to try to make a pick for the split-pushing top laner. You knew that the enemy team was 4-strong, shoving into bottom lane, and then if not giving it up immediately, like leaving someone around to dangle as bait and then have them get picked off underneath your turret as well. Like, unfortunate. Not a good trade for San Antonio right there.
Seeing a completely different situation for San Antonio is now they're the ones for the first time who are behind 3k gold and Baron spawning in the next 30 seconds. Both teams are going to scramble to try and secure this objective. Able to secure Baron and get one or two kills off, that might be the game.
Wanton Agent goes a little bit deep, but Nick is the one that's caught out. Varus taking his sweet time to walk up from base. They're trying to establish vision control just around this area, so that means that Nick and company are able to grab that one, but Wanton Agent still wants more. There's the engage on Alistair, maybe not the target I would have picked, but he does force out the ultimate. There's a call of the Forge God. Meanwhile, Shadowy Figure disappears to Lemur's LeBlanc. And the Featherstorms forced out of Hellawong Hank, who's in the middle of the rest of his team, flashing away for the recall on his feathers. He's able to keep him alive for just a little bit longer, but not out of reach from LeBlanc. And that's the Emerald Trespass. Arbery actually picking up the kill on that one. Infernal Susan, meanwhile, trying a 2v1, a triple kill for Lemur. He might not be able to get away from Tarsier. Just kidding. The Ace coming out for TCU, and that's a clean 5-4-0.
LeBlanc Ace, that might just be the entire game there. You saw in that last team fight, once again, it's another situation where Shadowy Figure was not able to defend Hello, I'm Hank. It's a very strong bot combo, but only if Rakan is there to protect Zaya. Just as you saw the first time around, Wand and Asian step a little bit too far forward, trying to get the pickoff onto Alistar, and instead, he's able to open the gateway for Nick to get the deletion Rakan there, and since Rakan was gone, Zaya soon fell suit. That also opened the gate for Lemur to get a triple kill. Surprised that they were unable to close out the game there, but at the very least, that's going to be a free Baron buff coming on to TCU, and they're looking to close out this game very shortly. 21 to 9 kills. A very different game, very different result than what we saw in game one there.
Yeah, I don't disagree with their decision right there to go for the base instead of the Baron immediately, but Lemur's in a little bit of trouble, did get the ultimate out again from Shadowy Figure, but way returning way more than Shadowy Figure would have bargained for. Nick's a little bit low, is able to secure the Baron before taking too much damage from Xerath, but the Rite of the Arcane might have something to say about that. Meanwhile, Transmuted is cut off from the rest of his team. Hello, I'm Hank, picks that off. There's a call to Forge Gun in a confined space that could be very powerful, but Shadowy Figure needs to watch out here. Lean Mealer, meanwhile, had to go back in to try to salvage that one. The shutdown under Hello, I'm Hank's gonna be feeling pretty good about that one. Southwind, meanwhile, is still caught. Triple kill for Zaya this time around. Nick gets the good knockup. And where is he going? He's just getting the heal from his ultimate to try to escape. Does make it out of that one. But 3-for-1 picked up by San Antonio, and that gives them doesn't give them Baron control because Baron was picked up, but definitely overcommitted a little bit for that one.
Oh, wait a minute. Nick's looking for a little bit more here. Decides to back off instead, but if you're in TCU's situation, that's definitely not how you wanted that to go down, because that only means that you have two Baron buffs up. That's going to make that base a little bit harder to siege, especially since it's the inner turrets now in the base itself that are open to being picked off. You're seeing the Winions, the minion waves. TCU has a lot better minion wave control, and you're seeing that that's actually starting to pay off now as they got a turret for free off of those minions.
Yeah,
I'm
seeing a cheeky Elder Drake sneak instead. There was a red ping, so even though there's no vision there currently, they know that this is happening. But I think the blasting code just a little bit too far away means that Kha'Zix not close enough to make any sort of steal attempt. An Elder Drake and Baron buff now. On 5, all Elder Drake on 5, Baron buff on 2 is still a very, very potent combo, especially with that 6,000 gold lead that they've built up for themselves.
She is definitely going to look to close out the game now. 36 minutes in here, LeBlanc is going to start to fall off very hard now, but thanks to that Baron buff and the Elder Drake going on to in their favor, they're definitely going to be in a position to close out this game. But you're seeing a 3-2 split here. A little bit strange. Trying to pressure either the top inhibitor or the bot turret and try and close out the game there. One more team fight in TCU's favor is definitely going to be the game. However, if we see another repeat of what happened in the Baron pit, allow San Antonio to change the tides. They only have a small window of opportunity. It's going to be up to them to siege the advantage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's
speaking of siege, that's going to be TCU threatening bot turret now.
5 men strong. It's going to be very important for San Antonio if they have to go for a fight to defend their base. And they have to try to isolate somebody on the enemy team. We saw it last time, it was Jarvan that got cut off. If they can get Lemur to overcommit or Arbitrary in the wrong spot, then they could win a defensive fight. But Arbitrary's already got the GA finish as well. And speaking of LeBlanc, I think even the question of whether or not she's going to fall off isn't really that much of a problem for her, as there are 4 squishy members on the enemy team, so you see her do a number on everybody already so far. Even Wanta Asian not too keen to try to tank up the brunt of that combination. Tarsier's waiting along the wings. Nick is being a little funny inside that wall, trying to get the long-range blades reach just for a little bit of harass as the rest of his team pushes minions into the base.
Clear that they have San Antonio that is on their side. They're able to stop the siege from happening by controlling that minion wave oh so perfectly. The amount of damage with Zaya's crit build here being more than enough to keep the minions at bay, and that's going to be stalling out that Baron rather effectively.
Yeah, Zaya, Xerath, the 2x champions, very hard to wave clear against, it turns out.
Trying to get that pick off, it's not just coin.
Here it comes, the long range roots going to land into the Rakan, pushes him backwards, but Nick's also very low. He does have still have the ultimate to heal up, remember that. But there's this huge team fight within the base. They're forced back away from the turret already, even back to the Nexus already. Tarsier is going to go down, 2 kills down, and the turret as well. That means Zaya is going to go down next. Wanta Asian still alive, but he's caught in the middle between a cow and the LeBlanc place. And he's going to get shoved out of his own base by Galliver. Lemur wants more, flashing over for that kill. Getting greedy, might regret this decision as he goes down. But meanwhile, the Nexus is the next target. No more killing champions where you can just kill the game. And that's TCU bringing it back to a 1-1 against their opponents in this matchup tonight.